will talk about planning time through the use of one of the most popular project management tools, the Gantt chart. Let's start with a bit of history. The Gantt chart is a type of bar chart that illustrates a project schedule named after its inventor, Harry Gantt, who designed such a chart around the years 1910 and 1915. One of the first major applications of Gantt charts was by the United States during World War I at the instigation of General William Crozier. Now let's go back to project planning and start from what we have. We discussed the WBS to have a clear overview on the activity needed for the project. And then we introduced the OBS to have a similar view on the resources, and then we match them with the RAM. Then we define the duration of each activity, knowing who is going to do what. Still, how much time do we need to complete the whole project? We know that we are not going to perform all the activities in a long sequence, but we may also have various activities overlapping. Moreover, we need also to consider that the activities are not all independent, but there may be a logical dependencies among one and the others. The Gantt chart will help us taking into consideration these aspects. First of all, we need to define the dependency among the various activities. Given the list of all the activities, let's say coming from the lowest layer of the WBS, we should start defining if there are logical relations among them. In particular, we may have four types of logical relations among activities, defining a predecessor and a successor among the two activities. Let's consider the example of the creation of a new piece of road. The logic may be finish to start. The predecessor must finish before the successor can start. For example, the land must be purchased before road building can start. The arrow represents the logic relation among the activities. A second type is start to start. The predecessor must start before a successor can start. For example, the road excavating must start before asphalt can be laid. Finish to finish, the predecessor must finish before the successor can finish. For example, laying asphalt must be completed before line painting can be completed. And finally, start to finish. The predecessor must start before the successor can finish. For example, road excavating must start before line painting can be completed. Let's say that on a general basis, the finish to start is the most common, but it may be useful to know all of them for proper planning. Once we define the logical relations among activities, we would know, for each activity, which are its predecessors and its duration. For example, we may have a very simple project with four activities, A, B, C, and D. A and B has no predecessors, while C has both A and B as predecessors, and D has C as predecessor. Finally, A last 3, B last 5, C last 3, and D last 7. Now, we can build a Gantt chart with a bar for each activity. It is a very simple tool, which has on the horizontal line the time, and then we've got some bars on the vertical axis representing the various activities. Let's build a simple example through the numbers in the table. Activity A is planned to start in 0 and to end in 3, since it has no predecessors. Activity B is still planned to start in 0, again, since there is no predecessors also in this case. But it lasts 5, so it will end in 5. Activity C is different. It has two predecessors, A and B. Therefore, it needs to wait for both the activities to end before it can start. Lasting 3, it will start in 5 and finish in 8. Similarly, activity D cannot start before 8, since it needs to have C finished. And lasting 7, it will finish in 15. Even though the sum of the duration of all the activities is 18, the project lasts 15, as you can see from the various activities overlapping on the Gantt chart. The modern version of the Gantt chart is usually created through a software, which shows also the logic relations among the activities with the use of the arrows that I've been drawing while positioning the activities on the Gantt chart. We can also use the Gantt chart to control the project, to show the status of a project. In that case, normally, we use the line. We can say, for example, that activity A actually started in 0 and finished in 3. So we've got a point here representing that the activity is actually finished. If we take B, which actually started as well in 0, we may realize that it didn't finish in 5, but lasted one more period and finished in 6. Activity C had to start in 5, while it started in 6, and had to finish in 8 and finish in 9 instead. Activity D started in 9, and now we are at time 11. The activity is still not over yet. How's the project going? Are we late? Well, it depends on what we are doing. If we simply hope to cover the lost time during D, well, probably we'll be late. If we'll use the time we have in front of us to replan our behaviors, change the way in which we are working, and so on, we may still recover. This means managing a project. The tool itself won't tell us if we will be late or not. It can tell us that we are not on schedule, according to what we planned. The Gantt chart is just showing it in an easier way. The Gantt chart can tell us something more that can help us significantly in managing a project. If we look at this simple example, we may realize that the activities are not all the same. Let's take A, for example. If A would last 4 instead of 3, it would have no impact on C or D. While, as we said, if B lasts 6 instead of 5, it would delay C of one period. This means that A and B are two different types of activities. A is a non-critical activity. This means that it has a float or a slack, an amount of time in which the activity may be delayed without impacting on the total planned duration of the project. Usually, non-critical activities are represented in blue. For activity B, C, and D, this is not true. If any of them would be late of one period, our project would require, with this planning, one period more. In other words, they are critical activities. Their slack, or float, is null. Usually, critical activities are represented in red, which is the case of B, C, and D. B, C, and D will be defined as the critical path, the activity chain that brings from the beginning till the end of the project, defining the duration of the project, which in this case is equal to 15. Please, pay attention to a very relevant detail. This criticality is considered only regarding time. A critical activity is not, by definition, more important or more relevant than a non-critical activity. We are just saying that, from a time perspective, we should highly monitor these activities because there is no slack. One last comment. The calculation of floats and the definition of the criticality of activities is not straightforward in real projects with more than 4 activities, as we've seen in this simple example. There are tools, like the network diagram, to properly manage the complexity and calculate the floats. Still, we are not seeing them, since usually we build a Gantt chart with the support of a digital tool that automatically calculates the floats and the criticality of activities, showing directly also the colors we've mentioned in this simple example. One comment on this. Even if the Gantt chart originally was focusing only on time, today it is pretty easy to find project management softwares that, just clicking on the activity, will show also the people involved and possibly even the risk connected to the activity and its planned cost.